Okay, good afternoon then. We'll start with the next topic. As much as possible, you mute your audios. Whenever you have any questions or something, you can unmute and you can talk to me. Otherwise, try to mute. People are still joining. Okay, let's start with the next chapter. In the last videos, whichever I had sent, in that we have already discussed deadlocks. There, the important topic is that problem itself, but I hope you may not be clear with the problem which I have shared through the video. So once you will be back to the college, we'll solve some examples, then we can go ahead. So that will be a revision for you guys. Then, so instead of waiting for that, problematic, we'll go ahead with the next chapter of the third module, that is memory management. Already in the first chapter we had a little introduction about this, how memory management works, but here we'll try to see in detail what is a memory management and what is a swapping, what is memory allocation, phasing, all these things one by one we'll start. Then in the first chapter I had said CPU can directly access till main memory, that is nothing but CPU can access all the data which is stored in the register. CPU can directly access data which is stored in the cache memory. CPU can directly access the data which is stored in the main memory. But CPU cannot directly go and access the data which is stored in the secondary storage, that is your hard disks. It cannot go directly to that and it can access. So for that purpose, we need to do some kind of alternate adjustment, how we can bring the data from secondary storage to the primary storage, that is main memory. So whatever the data is required by the CPU, that should be there in main memory. It should not be there in secondary storage. But most of our data will be stored in secondary storage. When we want our CPU to get execute, we have to bring our data from secondary storage to the primary storage. That is what a written program must be brought into the memory and placed within the process for it to be run. That is nothing but it should be brought from secondary storage to the primary storage. Main memory and registers are the only storage CPU can access directly, because apart from main memory and registers, CPU will not access anything directly. Indirect access only is there. Next, main memory can take many cycles, because CPU takes one cycle to access the data which is stored in the registers. CPU takes one or two cycles to access the data which is stored in the cache memory. CPU takes more than two cycles to access the data which is there in the main memory. So that is what is the introduction for this. So coming to this, already we know each process will be having its own memory space. So this is a one main memory diagram we can assume. So each process will be having its own memory space, as it is written here. This is the address reserved for one process. This is another address. This is like this. Each process 2,56,000 is reserved for the operating system. Usually operating system will be loaded into the main memory when you switch on the computer, and it will be occupying the lower part of your operating system. Sorry, main memory. So it is already there in 2,02,256 memory location. So that is after the operating system, the remaining memory of your main memory will be used for processes. No, 2,56,000 to 3,40,000 is used for the process one. Then the next one, two, three, like this. Many processes can come and occupy in the main memory. But we are not interested in that. No, right now we are interested in this base register and the limit register. Base register is nothing but starting address of any process. So that is called as that address will be there in a register called as base address, sorry, base register. And the last address what the process can access, that will be holded by one more register called as limit register. So whatever the addresses are between this base register and limit register are the legal addresses for this particular process. This particular process can access all the addresses which are coming under 3 lakh 40 to 1 lakh 29, whatever the number is there in between, whatever the addresses comes, those addresses will be called as a legal addresses for this particular process. So that is what we call it as a legal address, and those legal address will be decided by base register and the limit register. Keep this in mind, because in future when we are discussing about the paging, there we need, why we need the base register and the limit register. Base register is nothing but it is a starting address. Limit register is nothing but last memory access done by the particular process. So whatever the addresses comes between this, that is called as legal. Next, coming to the addresses, different addresses will be generated at different time. One will be getting generated compile time, load time, execution time. This we'll see in detail later. But as of now, we have multiple address generation times. It may be at the compile time, or it may be at the load time, or it may be at the execution time. So first we'll try to see what is logical difference between logical address and physical address. Physical address is nothing but the one which is there in your secondary storage or a memory unit. The logical address is nothing but the one which is getting generated by the CPU, because CPU can directly access only the main memory. So CPU generates the address with respect to the main memory, because CPU don't have an idea that your data is in there in the secondary storage. It is not having any idea. It will generate the addresses based on, by assuming that data is present in the main memory. Even though data is not there in the main memory, it is there in the secondary, but CPU generates the address by assuming that it is there in the main memory itself. So that is why it is called as logical address or a virtual address. Physical address is nothing but the actual address from where we access the memory. So that is the difference between your logical and physical address. Then coming to the memory management unit, there is a separate hardware unit. This will map your logical, because I said there are two addresses. If CPU wants to access something, first it will generate the logical address. But in logical address, we don't have the data because it is stored in the secondary storage. So we have to map this logical address to the physical address. So that mapping will be done by our special hardware device called as memory management unit. So this, what it will do, whatever the address is getting generated by the CPU, that is the logical address, will be mapped to the physical address in order to get the actual data which is stored in the secondary device. Next, coming to the dynamic relocation using relocation register. This is CPU, whatever we have discussed till now, it is in terms of diagrammatical representation. CPU generates, it is assuming that 346 is the address of the instruction what it wants to access. But actually in 346, we don't have any data that is there in the secondary storage. What this MMU will do, it will find out the physical address first, because that will be, we are going to get by the relocation register. Then it will add the logical address plus this physical address. Then relocation register value, both together will become a physical address. Then if you go to the 14,346, you will get the actual data. Actual address generated by CPU, this is 346 is a logical. If you go to this address, you will not get any data. To get the actual data, we need to map this logical address to the physical memory address, means where our data is actually stored. So for that purpose, we are going to use this MMU. MMU help us to map this logical address to the physical address. So that is why we are using the MMU. How physical address will be generated? That is logical address plus relocation register content. If you add together, then you will get the physical address. So then coming to the one important topic, this is all about the introduction, what we have seen, that is swapping. Swapping is nothing but interchanging the contents from one place to the another place. This is in our real life, day to day we use. So here also in memory management, we use the same policy, that is nothing but, so we'll see the diagram here. Operating system will be there in the first memory address and the remaining process will be sitting here. Then assume that no main memory is full. some other data wants to enter into this. So what I have to do is, whatever the data which is sitting in the main memory, that I have to send it to the secondary storage. Backing store is nothing but secondary storage. First, some of the part of the processes which are sitting in the main memory without the execution, I have to send them out. That process I call it as a swap out. Once you send the process P1 from main memory to the secondary storage, some space will get free in the main memory. Then in place of that process memory, I can bring the process P2 inside. So this is what we call it as a swap in, because if you are bringing the data from secondary storage to the primary storage, then that is called a swap in. If you are sending the used data from primary storage to the secondary storage, that is called as swap out. So this entire topic we call it as a swapping. This will be mainly done because this memory is not capable of holding all the data at a time. So for that purpose, whichever the processes are presently getting executed, only that data we bring from the secondary storage to this. Once they finish the execution, we will send that back to the secondary storage, and again we'll bring the new process into the main memory. So this sending out and bringing in, this process we call it as a swapping. In many of the question paper he had asked, explain the swapping. Usually he used to ask for the 4 to 5 marks. So what if CPU wants to access, but if first he will request the main memory, but if the data is not available in the main memory, then main memory will request the data from the secondary memory. Then secondary memory try to shift the data from secondary to the primary. If space is not available, some of the data from primary has to be sent back to the secondary. So that process we call it as a swap out. Then once it finishes the execution, it has to be sent back. Hello, is it clear with the swapping?
Anyone? Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay, next, the one more important topic with respect to the exam point of view, that is contiguous memory allocation. Here, usually he will ask the problem only. Problem means very simple and small problems. He will ask for 2 to 3 marks or maximum of 4 marks. In this case, all the memory will be allocated continuously. That is nothing but one after the other. Random fashion will not allocate the memory. The memory will be allocated one after the other. Already we know that operating system will be sitting in the first memory location, that is 0 to some location, and the remaining memory locations will be occupied by our user processes. We'll go ahead with this continuous allocation. So we have seen some diagram here. Operating system here sitting here in the first part of the memory, then process 5, process 8, process 2. Then what the operating system has done, process 8, it has sent out, that is nothing but it has done the swapping here. Process 8 has completed the execution. It has been sent to the secondary storage. Then this part has become free now. So this free part we call it as a hole. Then again, operating system, what it has do, in place of some part of whatever the free space we had here, in that free space, some part of this free space has been occupied by process 9. One more process has been brought from secondary storage to the primary. That is nothing but swap in has occurred. Here we have done swap out. Then here we have done swap in, because from secondary storage to the primary, process 9 has come. But process 9 has not occupied the complete space which has left by the process 8. Only some part it has occupied, and remaining space is still free. Then again it is called as a hole which is left out in the main memory. Then again, so one more new process has come, that is process 10. Still it has not occupied the entire process. Only some part has been occupied. Some more memory space is free only. So this hole is nothing but block of available memory of various size are scattered through the memory. That is nothing but in some places the hole may be here, and in some places hole may be here and some more. So the available address spaces will be scattered throughout the memory. It is not that it will be there in the beginning or at the end. It will be scattered. The free space may be here, a free space may be here or at the end. So it is randomly scattered throughout the memory location. So that is how it has been declared. Done. It will be more clear with respect to the example. So to do this continuous memory allocation, we use three strategies, that is first bit, best bit, worst bit. Understand carefully, because this is the question he is going to ask. Explain the first bit, best bit, worst bit. First bit is nothing but allocate the first hole that is big enough. Allocate the smallest, best bit is nothing but allocate the smallest hole that is big enough, must search the entire list unless ordered by the size. Next, worst bit, allocate the largest hole, must also search the entire list. So we'll see with an example directly instead of reading the definition. The first bit, see here, the refer the upper part. This is a main memory. There it was vertical. Here I have drawn the horizontal. There are holes available. So first hole is of 10K size and second hole is of 20K. Third is of 15K. One minute. Fourth is of 50K. Fifth, 40K, 20K and 35K. So this is how the holes are available. That is nothing but nobody is using this memory now. So these holes are available. So request comes of P1. 32K. Then according to the first bit, I will start searching from here. The first hole which is available is 10K. But the requested size is 32K. Though as per 10K is not greater than 32K, then I cannot fit this 32K in 10K. So I will reject. Next, I will check the second hole, whether it is able to satisfy the request of P1. No, because 20K is less than 32K. Third hole is also not sufficient to satisfy. Then fourth hole, that is 32K. Sorry, this is best bit example, I think. First bit is here. Okay, 10K, 20K, 15K, 50, 40K. 10K is not capable of satisfying 32K. Then 20K is not capable of satisfying 32. And 15K is not capable of satisfying. Then we have 50K. 50K is greater than 32K. Then definitely it is able to satisfy. So I can allocate P1 for this hole. So P1 will go and sit in this particular hole, which is having a size of 50K. The first largest block which is able to satisfy the request, that is called as first bit. Then the second, then worst bit. In worst bit, what we will do? The first larger, in worst bit, what we'll do? Instead of searching for the first one, we will search for the largest one among this entire list. Among this entire list, which is the largest one? 10K, 20K, 15K, 40K, 50K, 20K, 35K. Among all these things, which is the largest one? 50K. Then I will allocate to the 50K only, which is available as the largest. In fact, according to the first bit, first is 10K, it is not sufficient. 20K, it is not sufficient. 15K is not sufficient. But 40K, it is capable of satisfying the request. But according to the worst bit, I have to search the largest one among all this. The largest one is 50K. Actually, according to the first bit, I should allocate here. But I'm not allocating here according to the worst bit. According to the worst bit, it should sit in the largest hole which is available in the entire memory. So that is 50K. Then coming to the best bit heading is not visible here. So in this best bit, 32K is out of this, which can occupy this P1 more efficiently. That is nothing but even 50K can satisfy the 32 request. Even 40K can satisfy the P1 request. Even 35K can satisfy the request. But which will efficiently satisfy the request of P1? If you allocate for the 50K, how much memory will get waste here? 50 minus 32, 18K of memory will get waste. If you allocate this, 8K memory will get allocated. But if I allocate for the 35K, only 3K memory will get waste. So that is nothing but the nearest block for this I have to search. The entire list you have to search, which will efficiently satisfy the 32K, that should be allocated to the P1. Even though 50 and 40 also can satisfy, but 35 will waste less memory compared to the 50 and 40. So you can fit the P1 in the first last one. So that this is called as best bit. Best bit is nothing but you have to select the one which is capable of satisfying more efficiently. In first bit, you have to start searching from left to the right. The first hole that is capable of satisfying the request, that will be allocated. in worst fit from the entire list, you have to search the maximum one which is capable of satisfying the request. So these are the three strategies which we have used as a to allocate the contiguous memory allocation. Because here whatever the holes are available, this should be filled. So for the filling those holes, we have used three strategies, that is first fit, best fit, worst fit. First fit is nothing but the first largest block which is able to satisfy the first hole that is big enough. Best fit is nothing but allocate the smallest hole that is big enough. You have to search the smallest hole which can satisfy the request. So that is, for this time will be more taking, but it is the efficient one. Worst fit, you have to search the largest hole among all. That is how it will work. So this is all about the best fit, worst fit, and the best fit. First fit. Is it clear? Students?
Yes, sir.
Any doubts with respect to this first fit, best fit, worst fit?
No, sir.
Okay. We have one example also at the end. I'll solve that. There you can more, you'll be more clear with that. So before going to that, the important topic, that is fragmentation. Fragmentation, we have two types. Before going to the definition, we'll see the types. That is external fragmentation and internal fragmentation. Total memory space exists to satisfy the request, but it is not contiguous. We'll see directly with the example. See here, the fragmentation, external, I think image is not so clear, but external fragmentation, the first diagram is external fragmentation. 10K hole is there, 20K hole is there, 50K hole is there, 5K hole is there, 20K hole is there, 30K hole is there, 10K hole is there. But already 50K, 20K, 30K is occupied by P1, P2, P3. Now available holes are 10K, 5K, 10K. So total, if you add all together, it is 10 plus 20, 30, 5, 35 plus 10, 45 is available. 45 KB of size is available. A new request of P4 of a size 30K. One more process is requesting to come inside. The size of that is 30. 30K it is requesting. So actually, is there any block available in this entire list? First one is 10K, I cannot fit here because the size of the requested block is 30. Second hole is 20K, I cannot put it here because the 30K is greater than 20K. Third one is 50K, but it is already occupied by P1. Fourth one is 5K, 30K is more than 5K, I cannot fit here. 20K, it is already occupied by P2. Next is 30K, it is already occupied by P3. And last one is 10K. It is 10K is less than 30K, so I cannot allocate. Then where I have to give the chance for the P1? Actually, if you see the memory available, total memory available, if you add all the available blocks, 10K plus 20K, 30K, 35 plus this 10, 45K is available. We are requesting how much? 30K. Even though the requested amount of memory is available here, but it is not in the continuous format. 10K is available here, 20K is available here, 5K is available here, and 10K is available. It is not continuous. Even though we are requesting only 30K, but the available memory is 45K, but that 45K is scattered throughout the memory. So that is why I am not able to satisfy the request of P4. So this problem, we call it as an external fragmentation. Even though we have the space to satisfy the request, but that space is not continuous. If it is continuous, I would have allocated 30K. So this problem, we call it as a external fragmentation. Then the another problem is internal fragmentation. The same question, this is 10K, I think it is not visible clearly. 10K, 50K, 40K, 30K, 20K, 40K. Then another request will come, which is requesting 35K. Then another P5 process is coming, which is requesting 35K. Then first one, 10K cannot fit here. 50K is already occupied by P1. Then third one is 30K, it is requesting 35, cannot fit. Fourth one, it is already occupied. Only available is 40K. I have to allocate here. So 35K, if I give P5 here, then P5 will use how much memory out of 40K? It will use 35K, but actual size available is 40K. Then the another 5KB will be remaining in this particular hole, because this P5 process which was requesting 35k, it will make use of 35 out of 40. Then another 5k will be remaining in this particular hole only. This part of the memory problem we call it as an internal fragmentation. Here the memory is getting wasted, that is because this memory is not continuous. So that is called as external fragmentation. Here after allocating, some part of the memory is remaining in each hole. So that memory we call it as an internal fragmentation. Are you clear with the internal and external fragmentation?
Yes, sir.
Internal is nothing but after allocating, because we are not exactly allocating, but 35 is getting allocated in the space of 40, then definitely 5k is remaining in this particular hole. That 5k memory wastage, we call it as a internal fragmentation. But here, all the memory spaces are available. So we are requesting 30k, but it is not available in a continuous fashion. It is available in a scattered fashion. So here also we are wasting the memory, because these, even though memory is available, but we are not able to satisfy the request of 30k. So this wastage, we call it as a external fragmentation. Even after allocating, some part of the memory is getting wasted. That we call it as a internal fragmentation. So we'll see one example from the question paper. It is given memory partitions of 200k. He has given the memory partitions of 200k, 700k, 500k, 300k, 100k, 400. Apply first bit, best bit, worst bit to place 315, 427, 250 and 550. So using first bit, best bit, worst bit, we have to allocate these 315, 427, 250. First, we have to draw the memory like this. He has given a memory partitions in the first part of the problem. That is, first block is of 200, second block is of 700, because he has mentioned here. Third block is of 500, fourth block is of 300, fifth block is of 100, and the last block is of 400. In these blocks, I have to put 315, 427, 250, 550. Then, according to the first bit, now I have to take 315 first. Where I can put in the first block, can I put, because 200 is not capable of holding the 315. So I cannot put here. Then the second one is 700. Whether 700 is capable of holding 315? Yes. So according to the first bit, the first largest block which is capable of satisfying will be allocated. So 315 will be allocated here. And the next request is 427. Next request here, the 500 block is there. 427, I can paste it here. Next, 250 is there. I have a 300 block, so I can paste it here. Next, 550 request is there, but the next block available is 100. I cannot. Next available block is 400. I cannot. Then no more blocks are available. So according to the first bit, in exam also you should write in such a way that according to the first bit, I am able to satisfy 315, 427 and 250, but 550 cannot be satisfied using first bit algorithm. Next, coming to the best bit. In best bit, what we need to do, first we take a 315, we have to search the smallest hole which can satisfy the request, that is 315. 200, first of all, 200 is less than 315, so reject it. Second one, 700. In fact, 700 is able to satisfy, but I cannot take this because it is the largest one. Next, 500 is also able to satisfy. We have to check any other. 300 is able to satisfy? No. 100 is able to satisfy? No. Then 400. So, total available, total three blocks are able to satisfy. That is 700 block, 500 block and 400 block. Out of these three, which is the smallest one? That is 400. Then you have to allocate 315. The smallest hole which can satisfy the request. According to the best fit algorithm, the smallest hole which can satisfy the request. So according to this, 315 will be allocated in 400th block. Next request is 427. 427 can be satisfied by two blocks. That is 700 block and 500 block. But which is the smallest one? 500 blocks. So that is why I have pasted 427 in 500th block. Next request is 250. 250 can be satisfied by 300. Only 300 is available as of now, because 400, 500 is already allocated. Even 700 is available. But out of this, which is the smallest one? 300 is the smallest one. So I'll allocate here. Next is 550. 550 can be satisfied only by the 700. So allocate here. So according to the best fit algorithm, we are able to satisfy all the requests. Next, coming to the worst fit. In worst fit, the definition of worst fit is, for the first request, you have to search the largest block. So 315, if you take, the largest block is 700. You allocate here. Next, 427. The next largest block among this is 400, 500. So 500 is the next largest. So allocate here. Next, 250. Next largest block is 400. Allocate here. Next, 550. Is there any block to satisfy 550? No. So in exam also you should write 550 cannot be satisfied using worst fit. Only 550 is getting, all the requests are getting satisfied only by the best fit. In first fit as well as in worst fit, we are not able to satisfy. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So usually he will ask, explain contiguous memory allocation with an example, or he will give a problem like this. It will be for 4 to 5 marks, including theory. It will be 8 marks question. First, you need to explain this memory partition, this diagram and this definitions you need to explain. Then internal fragmentation and external fragmentation definition. And then the problem you need to solve. So this is how the question will be asked in the exam. So the next important topic is phasing. This we'll see in the next class, because it is again one more definite question for the exam. Explain the phasing concept of the operating system, which will take around 40 minutes. So we'll solve this topic in the next. So if you have any problem in this, whatever the topics I have covered today, you can ask me. So we have seen now what is swapping. Swapping is nothing but sending in and out. Then we have seen contiguous memory allocation. There are three strategies we have used: first fit, best fit, worst fit, and then the fragmentation, external fragmentation and internal fragmentation. And then the one problem also we have solved. In many question papers, same kind of problem. He will give a memory partitions and he will give the requests also in order. You have to apply first fit, best fit and worst fit. Based on that, you have to try to allocate. If it is able to satisfy, write it as, yes, we are satisfying and we are able to allocate all. Otherwise, you can write it as not able to satisfy all the requests. Yes, any doubts with respect to this? Otherwise, I'll close the class. Then we'll see tomorrow again. Shall I close it?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Thank you all. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Mm-hmm.